Thank you so much. Excellent. So we have got just one more presentation to go. How are you guys feeling? You need to stretch and stand up. Don't leave, though. Just you can stand up. Here we go. Stretch a little. You know, the brain can only absorb what the butt can endure, is what they say. Okay. No one wants to stand up over there. All right. So don't wiggle now when we start this thing, because it's going to be, we're going to go deep here on PayPal. So, okay. Without further ado, let me introduce Dennis, who's going to talk to us a little bit of what they've been doing at PayPal. And what I sort of love about Dennis's presentation, I won't give away the secrets of it, is both what worked and what didn't work. So welcome aboard.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dennis.
Thank
you. Before I begin, is there any significance to any of the dates here on the wall, like birthdays, anniversaries?
Should think about that. I'm not going to give you the answer. But yes, there is deep significance to those
dates. Okay, because I feel like there's like...
They are not random dates.
You know, 1955 could be like Evan's birthday, maybe?
It could be, but it's apparently not. So, yeah. But okay. It's not that. So, yeah, you definitely, if you don't know, you should start looking that up.
Okay, very good. Before I begin, how many people, how many of you, show of hands, that are using Influx Enterprise? The clustering versions. Okay, so a good number of you. A lot of this is going to apply mostly for Influx Enterprise, but you can take away a lot of these tips for the open source version as well. So my name is Dennis Brazil. I'm manager for SLE monitoring for alerting, collectors, ingestion, so on and so forth at PayPal. In case you've been living under a rock, let me tell you a little bit more about PayPal. So PayPal enables digital and mobile payments on mobile payments on behalf of consumers and merchants worldwide. Our platform, which includes Venmo, Braintree, and Zoom, give 254 million active account holders the confidence to connect and transact in more than 200 markets around the world. And about the presentation. We assume that you have some working knowledge in InfluxDB, enterprise or not. What this presentation is about, we're going to focus just about scalability. What the presentation is not about alerting, capacitor, performance, all of that. It's more about scalability, making sure everything comes up. And it also is not about how to send money to your family. Okay. I know a lot of you might be asking that, like, why do I have money in my account yet? Why does it take 3 days? Talk to me offline after the presentation. I can give you a bit more information about that. But first, we had a need for a new host monitoring solution to replace antiquated monitoring solutions following with some of the requirements. We needed a reliable and extensible agent sitting on all of our systems to monitor basic OS metrics, CPU, disk, memory, third-party application, databases, so on and so forth. We also needed a time series database backend for reporting history. We needed the ability to monitor multiple Docker containers with a single agent. PayPal is actually on this journey right now where we're migrating all of our old antiquated applications that are, some are 20 years old, compiled in C++, that are required to run on like Red Hat 5. We're moving all of that into containers, into more modern operating systems. So a lot of these Docker hypervisors will be hosting 50 to 100 containers at once. So having one agent gathering metrics for all of those containers is really important to keep the overhead of the agent down across the whole system. Also, we had we wanted a smart alerting based on time series data. Why we chose Influx and a tick stack? And I was really disappointed where did Paul go? He's not here. But Paul, if you were here this morning, Paul said tick is dead.
He is. The guilty party has arrived.
He's going to be dead in a minute. Now I have to change everything all over again. No, but anyway, it's not completely dead. Of course, all the components will still be there, but packaged a little bit differently as we move on to the next generation. So let's go on real quick. So we were looking for one vendor to hopefully answer all of our problems. So we're going to go through each. Telegraph provides an extensible plugin-based architecture for monitoring everything that we need to monitor in our environment, plus Docker. InfluxDB provides a fast, scalable time series database. Chronograph provides an intuitive data explorer and query builder. Capacitor provides smart alerting capability. Also, all the components in the stack are single binaries, which makes it really, really easy to deploy in your infrastructure. Excuse me. Influx's architecture allows for further scalability and customization that you can build on top of it. As you've seen with all of the previous presentations throughout today, a lot of people have built a lot of value-added services on top of the stack. It makes it really easy to do that with their open APIs and also their open source mantra. And also technical support. I cannot tell you how much we've reached out to technical support. Tim will also, he said, I've called him many Friday nights and so on and so forth, saying, this is not working, we need help. So without further ado, the technical support has been really, really, really helpful to help us out in time of need. So our journey to scalability has not been so straightforward. We had to go through multiple iterations to get to a sort of nirvana that works for us right now. And so I'm going to go through each iteration and how it all came about. So the first iteration is, just like what Tim was saying, you just need 3 meta nodes and 2 cluster nodes, right? Okay, so that's what we did. We tried to throw 30,000 in a single data center right now, pointing to a single cluster. As you can see, those data nodes aren't very happy, right? Okay, so why didn't this work well? Well, there were too many writers with small payloads, right? Every single payload that you send to the database creates a wall entry, as Ryan was talking about in his database discussion. So you create many, many, many wall entries. So, 30,000 wall entries and, per minute in a single node is quite a bit to keep up with. Also, there's no buffering retention in case there's back pressure from the database. So a lot of this, out of the box, telegraph straight to data nodes, it's fire and forget. Yes, there is some buffering in telegraph, but again, that's all in memory, and you're constrained to the memory on the system. Also, you have a single point of failure condition as soon as one node fails. So again, when you have 2 nodes, as soon as one node fails, you're immediately in a sparse condition, all right? So then we moved on to the next generation. What changed? We added telegraph aggregators between the telegraph agent in the data center and the data node cluster behind it. What helped? The aggregators actually reduced the number of writes by combining the multiple tiny payloads into larger ones for fewer writes to the database. So if you can imagine you have 20, 30, 40,000 agents with small payloads of, say, 10 metrics, 20 metrics per payload, right? Those are, again, hundreds of thousands, millions of writes per minute. And the database has a hard time keeping up. It has to go through the journal of the wall and commit everything to the database, compact, do all this work that Ryan covered in his presentation. So the aggregators actually take all these smaller payloads, and we basically forklift like 5,000 metrics at once into one payload to the database. So that's one huge wall entry to commit to the database. Do I have that right, Ryan? Yep, okay, good. All right, what didn't work well, though, it's still kind of a fire and forget. These are telegraph agents, these are telegraph aggregators. Basically, one more thing about the aggregators. So They have the HTTP listener plugin set up, basically emulating what a data node does. It's listening on 8086, on port 8086. So it's basically the agent think that they are talking directly to the database. And instead, they're talking to the aggregator, doing a little bit more work for you. And again, there's no buffer retention in case the database is unresponsive. And again, you're in a single point of failure condition when one node failed, which is two data nodes. Now we come to iteration number three. All right, we added message queues, so a message queue bus right here. And basically, the aggregators send the data to the message queue. Then we added publishers, which you can see up here. These publishers actually consume messages from the message queue and post the data to InfluxDB to the cluster. And again, these are larger payloads, less number of writers. So instead of 20, 30, 40,000, instead of 20 or 30 or 40,000 writes to the database, we're down to 5. Doing all the writes on behalf of all the agents out in the data center. And then we added additional node to the cluster, and we set a replication factor of 3. So how that helped is that the message queue prevent data loss. They retain data until the consumers consume the data. The smart publishers watch for back pressure from the database, and they back off. If the database is not available, they back off. They don't consume messages or publish until the database is made available again. And we prevented an immediate spark condition with a replication factor of 3 with more data nodes. Make sense? All right. Cool. All right. So I'm going to go into a little bit more detail on each of the components that we just discussed about the aggregators. Losing my voice here. All right. What are the telegraph aggregators and how do they help? Again, they send larger payloads with fewer writes to the database, having better overall performance on the cluster. Again, reducing the number of wall entries, journal entries that need to be committed, compacted, compressed, all these things that need to happen in the database on the back end, writing 3 times, so on and so forth. Also, telegraph aggregators allow you to send to multiple outputs and formats. I'll get into a little bit more detail later on that, but basically, you can send to one InfluxDB cluster here. You can send to your MOM cluster, your monitoring cluster, send the same message to multiple outputs, and you can also send a third output, say, to JSON format. So Telegraph also has the ability to transform the line protocol format into JSON to be parsed by a custom consumer publisher that you might want to write yourself for your own environment. We'll go into more detail about that later. Also, you can filter, sanitize, and process at scale quickly. So it makes it really easy to instead of, you know, sending updates to 20, 30, 40,000 nodes in your data center and configure, you know, tag pass, tag drop, name pass, name drop, all those things, and filtering sanitization, you can actually do it at the aggregator level. So you only have to change the 5 nodes at the aggregator level, and you don't need to change, you know, the 50,000, 100,000 of nodes that you have in your infrastructure. So again, it can do the filtering for you at the next step up in the infrastructure. We'll go a little bit more into that as well. So brief animation here. So this is just a simple aggregator example. So these are all the telegraph agents in our data center sending to our aggregators VIP. And then what they do is it's taking all those smaller messages from all of the agents and sending one large payload directly to the database. Make sense? Some of you are taking pictures. By the way, I believe this is recorded and PDFs will be made available as well. So there's a lot of detail that I'm going to cover here. And I've also formatted this in a way that it could be a good reference document for those who want to use it. A little bit about the message queues. So how do message queues help? They actually store messages until the final destination is available. They also provide a common platform for publishing to just about any system, such as relational database, MySQL, machine learning system for further processing and alerting. Also, what we use internally is a fanout exchange. So again, the telegraph agents are sending one message to the telegraph aggregators, but let's say you need that same message to go to three or four different systems for different reasons. You want one to go to a relational database, you want one to go to a machine learning system, one to go to some kind of different alerting system, and then one to InfluxDB. Also, maybe replicate to another InfluxDB cluster or to your mom instance to monitor your infrastructure. So again, replicate to other InfluxDBs or clusters. Also, message queues actually can manage time to live for your messages. So this will help you not run out of disk space, as Tim was saying. You can, if your data node cluster is down for an extended period of time, you can say, you know what, only keep 1 hour's worth of data. Okay, and if it's down for, we've lost that data some, but we don't want to run out of disk space or memory or anything like that. So there's many features, that message queues can be taken advantage of. Kafka, RabbitMQ, ActiveMQ, there's so many out there. The possibilities are just unlimited. A bit more about the publishers. Publishers are the smart way to manage message flows. They actually consume from the message queues. And by the way, you might be confused. You call it a publisher, but you're consuming. The publishers are named as publishers because the final step where they need to push messages, the final step in the flow is to publish to some final destination, some external system somewhere. So they consume from message queues. They send heartbeat to ensure that the database is ready to accept messages. Also, they're smart in that they only deliver messages while the database is up. So what does it look like when you bring it all together? This is my favorite one. Telegraph agents are sending to telegraph aggregators. And then they go to the message queue, and then you have an Influx publisher consuming the messages from the message queue and then publishing to InfluxDB. But it gets better than this. This is not as simple. We actually have a more complex architecture. So all of the telegraph agents, again, are publishing to the telegraph aggregators, and then they're going to two different message queues. In this scenario, we're sending to one message queue. That one is for destined for InfluxDB. The other one is destined for a relational database, all right? What kind of application, why would you want to send it to a relational database? Say you want to come up with a quick dashboard of the final state. What was the last number of my CPU utilization on every host in my environment, right? You can quickly get that from a database. Again, you can get it from InfluxDB as well, but anyone can run a simple MySQL query and say select star from table and give me the last timestamp that this node reported data very quickly, right? Now, what does it look like though? So we're gonna go through the next step and you'll see the publishers. So one database will still be accepting messages, but what happened when InfluxDB is not responding, right? The messages bounce back. The publisher says, hey, I'm down. The database is down. Don't send any messages yet. As you can see, messages are still on the front end. They're still being sent to the message queue. It doesn't affect anyone. Nothing is being queued at the telegraph agents in your data center. The RDBMS queue is still publishing data. That is up, all right? As soon as the Influx database comes back online, Influx publisher says, oh, I just detected he's back online. I'm gonna start consuming messages again and publish. So that's how it manages the flow there. Good? All right. So other tips and best practices. And I've got quite a few of them. Avoid being greedy. Collect only the data that you need. Nothing more, nothing less. Start with a smaller, this is a big one, start with a smaller retention policy first, all right? It is easier to extend your retention policy than to reduce. Reducing retention policies do not clean up data from the former retention policy. Let me go into that just a little bit. Say you started with a retention policy of 3 months, right? And you realize, oh, it's storing too much data, we need to pull back. Let's pull back to 1 month. It does not, when you pull back to 1 month, those shards that were created with the retention policy of 3 months does not delete those old shards that are set. They have an expiration date of 3 months and it is set. So the expiration for every shard that's created is whatever the retention policy was set at that time. Okay, makes sense? So start small, grow slowly, and evaluate. And again, check which retention policy worked best for you, which is on the Influx blog on retention policy best practices. Ensure all of, now this is the big one. Ensure all of your data cluster nodes have the same machine characteristics, such as RAM, disk, disk I/O, IOP performance, network I/O, so on and so forth. This is really, really critical. A slower node can actually impair the performance of your whole cluster. We were just discussing with Tim at dinner last night, and I think they're going to be making some improvements on how to prevent a single node from taking down the rest of your cluster. Let me go into a little bit more detail on a real-world scenario and what really happened to us recently. So as you, this is a graph of all of our cluster nodes that with their data. The first one is the memory usage. The second one is the hinted handoff queue. And by the way, I totally agree with Ryan. Hinted handoff is total sadness, really sad. So you don't want to have that. And then finally, the third graph is the heap size. As you can see, we have one node that's really misbehaving. It was slowing down the rest of the cluster, and it was having a hard time competing or keeping up with the rest of the cluster. Let me step through these graphs really quick. So as you can see, the memory usage was getting up to 100%, and most likely the killer killed the process and went flat. And it crashed. Then, also you can see, while that slower node is in the cluster, the hinted handoff is persistent, it's consistent. It never really goes away, no matter what we did, all right? And so we knew that that slower node, so all of our nodes in our cluster were trying to send to that one slower node, and so you're gonna get hinted, you're gonna get the hinted handoff queue build up on the rest of your nodes in the cluster. And they're all trying over and over and over with retries. Also, the slower node had a larger heap size again, trying to keep up with all the writes coming to it, and it couldn't. So then, we decided to remove the data node from the cluster. Immediately, you can see that the rest of the cluster, the memory usage became slightly higher on the rest of the cluster, but a bit more balanced, nowhere near the slower node where before we removed it. The hinted handoff eventually depleted to zero across the board, just removing that one node. Now we have a much happier cluster. And the heap size balance on the remaining nodes as well. Any questions on that? Actually, we can go for questions later. Okay, also, another tip. Where possible, divide and conquer. Maintain regional clusters and roll up alerting to a single cluster. Or maintain regional telegraph receivers, aggregators, and forward to a single cluster if you need to, if you need to have one cluster. Also, I recently found that Wayfair did something very similar to what we did using Kafka, having receivers in multiple regions and then eventually pushing to a single influx. And for your reference, I've actually provided the URL for that article. If you want to take a picture now, go ahead. Otherwise, wait for the PDF after the fact. Also, another tip, scale up. The Easy IT blog did a great comparison with multiple query and write execution times with multiple different types of AWS instances. The summary was that more CPU power is really important for write throughput, and I think Ryan can probably attest to that, because you need a lot of CPU power to do the compaction, the compression, the write, all those things for writing. RAM and disk speed are really important for query throughput for reading. One important thing is that, as one of the closing remarks, is that, you know, if you can't measure it, you can't manage it. Measurements help us make educated, data-driven decisions quickly. They are what keeps us in business. It drives the need for products like InfluxDB. If you can't measure something to get results, you can't possibly get better at it. Worse yet, you won't know what you should be focusing on. It's nearly impossible to lose weight without stepping on a scale and to measure your results. If you don't, you have no idea whether you're succeeding or not. I had a really interesting conversation, an interesting ride with my driver on my ride here from the hotel. And, we were talking about my talk, and we were talking about data points and how everything is data. You know, if you can't monitor it, if you don't have metrics, you can't measure it. You know, I mentioned, your reviews are a data point. How fast you deliver, how satisfied your customers are a data point. All of these people you see here all around us are data points. You know, how many people are crossing a crosswalk? How many people are entering a building? How many, anything and everything. You know, how many people are riding on your ride service at this time? Everything is a metric, and without that, again, you don't know what you need to improve on. So again, you need metrics, you need measurement in order to improve and know what you need to focus on. Again, this journey would have not been possible without my team here. It was a total collaborative and a collective effort. It was a long journey, but it was definitely worth it to get to where we are today. Last but not least, I do want to cover one quick thing of the appendix. You guys can look at this after the fact when you get your PDF. I put a whole bunch of tips on here. If you want to cover any of these, we can, but I'm just going to go ahead and just leave this here for you guys. If you want to take a picture, go ahead and do that now. One big thing that I did, again, you know, as Tim pointed out, send your cluster stats and data to a different instance or cluster. Don't send it to the existing cluster. Avoid deleting measurements. Again, this is very expensive and taxing on the system. You need to uncompress, remove data, recompress, and recompact everything back to the database. A better thing to do if you need to remove old data is to remove the shard altogether, you know, using the metanode delete shard feature, remove shard feature, excuse me. Let's see, one more thing I did want to cover. Oh, if you are in a virtual machine environment and you're using an on-prem cloud solution, your own, make sure your VMs are not all on the same hypervisor, okay? Make sure it's spread out across hypervisors, so when that hypervisor dies, you know, your whole cluster dies. Believe me, I see some people laughing, but it's true. People actually don't watch for that, so spread it out across multiple hypervisors. Make sure that's all done. Use a reliable deployment strategy such as Puppet or Ansible. Also have a nanny-like system to make sure all of your services stay up and running. And real quick, again, you guys can review this, but this was a simple aggregator configuration that we have. Metric batch size is 5,000. So basically, we send 5,000 metrics at any given time to InfluxDB. The HTTP listener basically emulates what InfluxDB does, listening on port 8086. Also, again, remember I talked about you can make changes, filters, transformations, so on and so forth at scale at the aggregator level. So we have an HTTP listener tag drop. We have at PayPal, we have our InfraOp team, our cloud team. They spin up and spin down instances all the time, testing images, you know, making sure an image is up and down. And we don't want that. But all of those host names actually follow a certain pattern. And we don't want that in our system. Because again, it creates cardinality, things that we don't need to measure that follow a certain pattern. So we put that in there to say, don't send us anything that has this host name in the host tag. Then we have two different outputs. One is basically sending to InfluxDB, and the second one is sending to AMQP, and we're using RabbitMQ. Also, it transforms the data to, you see data format. Data format is JSON, and also bring it down to 1 second resolution. And finally, the name drop, you know, for this system that goes to, say, a relational database in JSON format, don't send me any measurements where that start with container. And also, again, scalability. Check your system limit. Check your open file count. Check your network settings, everything. If you're going to have 20, 30, 40, 100,000 writers writing to your Telegraph aggregators, you want to be able to take that many concurrent network connections, all right, and manage the flow. These are some of the settings that we've used in our environment as well. And with that, thank you. I'll take questions.
You mentioned earlier that your publisher nodes were sending heartbeats to your data nodes to make sure they were up. Well, what is the heartbeat? Are you sending a request to the ping endpoint, or are you actually trying to write a data point?
Yeah, so it's a combination of both. If I remember, so basically, once the database is responding, we keep sending. As soon as we get like a 500 error code, then we back off, we stop, we hold on to that message, and then that's when we start sending heartbeats at that point. So as soon as it stops becoming responsive, then we want to start that heartbeat process again. And then just keep sending and assume that everything is up until you get a 500 response, or 400, something like that. Something that's not a 204, I believe, is what the accept code. Does that answer your question? All right. Next one.
Hey, Dennis.
Yeah.
What is your final database structure? Is it just one database for all metrics, or you have some kind of segregation?
Very good question. So we have about eight, nine data centers, about 30,000 instances each, and they all have their own clusters. From those clusters, we actually do roll up metrics. So one of our publishers is a Sherlock publisher that you're familiar with. PayPal's been around for a long time. We actually have an enterprise time series database that we're stuck with right now, based on OpenTSDB, but it's a custom solution. So basically, we take the CPU, disk, memory metrics, and we roll all that up to the enterprise cluster for showing metrics at the enterprise level. So everything rolls up at that point. Does that answer your question? All right. Next question? Yeah.
Yeah. So you have a multiple aggregators, right?
Multiple what?
Aggregator.
Yes. So basically, in a given data center, we have like five aggregators behind a VIP.
Okay. So how did you partition data from the Telegraph aggregates to multiple aggregator?
Yeah, so we didn't want to modify the Telegraph agents to, in other words, all the Telegraph agents think they're posting to InfluxDB when they're actually posting to the HTTP listener on the Telegraph aggregators. And the Telegraph aggregators are running Telegraph.
Right.
But its only purpose in life is just to ingest metrics and pump data into message queues.
Okay, so did you assign the different ports for HTTP port for each aggregator to partition data?
We're using the same port, 8086, as InfluxDB. And the reason why we did that was because we didn't want to modify the default configuration for Telegraph.
Okay.
So the Telegraph agents are sending to port 8086 on a VIP, right? And then the aggregator sent to a message queue. And then the message queue sends, and then the publishers consume from that message queue and post to InfluxDB on port 8086 on that cluster, on a backend cluster. But the Telegraph agent never talk to the database directly.
Yeah.
They go through the flow.
The question was, I guess, do you partition your data or your aggregators do the same stuff like duplicate? You have five aggregators,
right.
Each
they
have
all do the same,
thing.
They're in a pool behind a VIP, and they all do the same thing. Basically, it's a horizontal scale. So, in other words, if the five aggregators can't do all the work, you just keep adding more aggregators if they can't keep up.
Oh, yeah. So you have some load balancers there.
Yeah, so the VIP is the load balancer. The VIP is in front of the aggregators in every AZ, or availability zone. Or a data center. All right, I'm being kicked off. Yeah. Thank you, everyone.
Sorry, Dennis, it's been great. Thank you so much.
All
appreciate
right.
it. Thank
yep.
you. Thank you. All right, last few words from me. Just wanted to make sure, A, you know where you're going tomorrow, but this is what you've come through today. This has been the agenda. As Dennis said, all these presentations will be available online as well as a video of each session. We should hopefully get that up by Friday, if not Monday. We'll send you an email with that as well as a survey. Survey says is how we decide what happens at whatever we do at the next Influx Days. So definitely want you to fill in the survey. If you do fill in the survey, we do make a small donation to Girls at Code. So sort of really important there. But for those of you coming tomorrow, Hyatt Regency San Francisco, not here. If you show up here, I don't know what's going on here. Be a different conference. So you're in the wrong place if you get here tomorrow. And if you go, I forgot to write that down, you wake up at 2 a.m. and you go, what did Mark say there? I knew it was important, I should have written it down. It's on the website. So you just go to Influx Days and you look at locations, day two location, and it's the Hyatt Regency. Three tracks, partitioners track. So think of that as, you know, sort of more of a, sort of, you know, getting a little bit more in depth in the thing. As seasoned developers, I need to know, go deep with it. And then, you know what, I just want Flux for the whole day and hanging out with Paul. We call that purgatory is the right track there. No, I lie. It was a great track to be at. So, you know, three important tracks to go. Again, if you haven't told us upstairs, anyone with a sort of a host badge, we just need it for food counts. We don't, you know, it's not, you just bring your badge tomorrow and you sort of get in. Next Influx Days. So if you're trying to, you know, book out your calendar, New York in March, London in June, and we'll be back somewhere here in San Francisco in November. Don't have a location for that yet. And if you want to continue the conversation, you've made some good friends here, you started to understand some things, you heard from Dennis, wow, where can I ask some of these questions? You know, go off to our community website. Can we just advance one? There we go. Join one of our meetups, join the community, but don't forget, download the database, start switch on the Flux previews, tech preview. Stop playing around with that. And I have one more important announcement. We're starting a new program called Influx Aces. And think about it maybe a little bit, you know, what sort of the Docker Captain program became to Docker. And this is going to be our award to our first ace. Cool jacket. Important to have swag, important things for marketing. Cool little ace thing. And so who does it go to? It goes to the person that we believe is worried about building up community either inside their organization, across organizations, out there sort of evangelizing and telling stories. And you're going, wow, is that me? And it's definitely someone in the room here. So who is it? Drum roll, please. Dylan, congratulations. You are our first ace. Congratulations. Here we go. And we'll do a little picture of you there. And Now we just hope we got the right size. Look at that. For Dylan. Thank you so much. And last but not least, thank you guys. Thanks for all you coming here. Thanks for you participating, for contributing. But I want to call out special just Chris, who's sitting up there in the booth, for all the work that she's done. Thank you, Chris. And thank you for the rest of the team that put this on. With that, there are drinks upstairs, cocktail reception. Go hang out there. Don't go out the door. Go straight upstairs. And we'll see you all tomorrow. Thank you very much.
Color in your cheeks. Do you ever get that feel that you can't shift the tide that sticks around like summer in your teeth? Are there some aces up your sleeve? Have you no idea that you're in deep? I dreamt about you nearly every night this week. How many secrets can you keep? Cause there's this tune I found that makes me think of you somehow, and I play it on repeat until I fall asleep, spilling drinks on my settee. Do I wanna know if this feeling flows both ways? Sort of hoping that you'd stay. Can't say tomorrow day.
you got the goods. Been wondering if your heart's still open, and if so, I wanna know what time it should simmer down and poker up. I'm sorry to interrupt, it's just I'm constantly on the coast. I've tried and to kiss you, I don't know if you